Thank you. That's a nice introduction. The early beginning of this afternoon, the head of our archives, Margaret Rosen, already has told you and shown you some of our expertises and experiments we do to turn the ZCAM in a smart place. Next, please. The classical equation comes from for spaces and architecture, urban spaces, places, whatever, comes from Frank Lloyd Wright. Who is the core of modern architecture. He defined the 20th century as an equation between machinery, material, and man. In this sense, many people of us still think we talk about space and about place. But I add to this equation, this still equation is valid. We still will have materials, machines, and produce with materials, cars, and tools, etc. But in addition, for the coming century, we have media, data, and man. And this means when we think, what is science? Then we can say, science starts where perception ends. Science starts, this means experiments and theories of science, when natural perception ends. In that sense, we could say, smart places start when we end thinking of place as space. Think of place as something with machines, material, with the think of space, something as data and media. This is a very important point. So smart place is a kind of paradox. Smart places only exist when we leave the place as a space. And when we move forward into information, energy, and data. So I will give you some examples of what we're trying to do at ZCAM. But before, I want to tell you that the idea of smart places, philosophically, is an old desire. So one of the first to articulate this desire was the German museum director, Alexander Dorner. He initiated the famous Cabinet of Abstract Art, constructed by Elie Stitsky between 1926 and 1922 in Hanover. And Alexander Dorner wrote already 1931 in a paper, the new concept of space in the visual art. And he wrote, so the traditional image of space is set of perspective, born half a millennium ago, in which space as an infinite, homogeneous, three-dimensional extension is viewed. Still, even Barth and De Boer think this kind of homogeneous, three-dimensional extension. The decisive novelty of cubism is already the displacement of the absolute standpoint by the relative standpoint. The artist perceives the essence of space is unreal in its universality. We have to walk in space to really experience in three-dimensionality. You see, they are always talking about experience. Thus, in the further course of abstract art developments, as in late constructivism, the extension of the bodies disappears. As you know from Descartes, we have two things, res extensa, this is the physical world, the extension of bodies, res cogitans, the extension of thinking objects, the brain and information. So we have the difference between extensions of bodies and extensions of data, etc. And the old thinking of place and space is the extension of bodies. We move with our bodies through cities. But in fact, in the new century, we may move as information, as data, through cities. The matter is dissolved into pure surface and lines that penetrate, now comes the word, massless and transparent. In this way, space is created as a crossroad of motion and energy streams. At 1931, I could not speak about data. It was too early. But it was thinking about motion and movement and energy streams. So this is the point of departure where we should think about abstract, about smart spaces. He wrote a wonderful book. He had to go away from Germany because of the Nazis, so he moved to New York, and he published a book, The Way Beyond Art, 1947, Alexander Dorner. And he dedicated it to the famous founder of the American pragmatism, John Dewey. And John Dewey even wrote the introduction of the book, 1946. And he said in the book, the idea of process, a citation of Dewey, the idea of process is making its way into that which is known And the idea of operations into our account of how we know. Event is the aspect of which comes out of. So idea of event is not something invented in 1960 by Fluxus. Event is a philosophy, event is a process. Came before Cage, before Schoenbrecht was invented by John Dewey. And he wrote the book already more than 10 years earlier, 1934, the same time when Donner wrote about space, etc. And the book he wrote was called Art as Experience, therefore our title, How Can You Experience Art in a Museum as a Smart Place? And he said, in his definition, art is experience, he said, art is the way how human beings use energies and resources of nature to expand the possibilities of life. So art is not for objects or commodities, trophies. To the art museum is there because people go in and look at famous paintings and famous objects by Cézanne and Picasso as trophies, like sightseeing. No? You see, you go to Paris to see the Eiffel Tower. And so you say, okay. And so you go to the museum and see Cézanne and see Picasso. You look at them as commodities, as trophies, not as a form of experience. And this is what he blamed. Said in the centuries before, he writes, said we have separated life from art. So the idea to combine life and art again was not an idea of the 60s by contemporary artists. It was already formulated as a philosophical problem in the early 30s. He says, now we come back to Dürner. Dürner. He says in his book, The Way Beyond Art, the energies latent in modernized aesthetics and art history may be used for the development of a new type of art museum. Such a museum could interweave these energies much more closely with the energies of life than aesthetics and art history has ever been able to do. In its consequence, such a museum could transform life itself much more intensively. What would be the new museum like? First of all, it would no longer propagate art in the old sense. It would cease to be a temple of humanistic relax. It would show art for what it is, the product of a relatively short evolutionary phase and part of strictly limited reality. As a whole, the museum would have to show the forces active behind the various historical realities using all possible, and now comes the point, sensory and intellectual resources of representation. So we can use intelligent interfaces to respond to this question, this demand, to motivate intellectual resources. In order to gain this new strength of this museum would have to be flexible, both as building and its inner arrangement. Flexible not for the sake of being always different, offering constant novelties, but for the sake of transforming its own identity under the pressure of life's continuous and autonomous change. A deeper and more vital understanding of life's growing forces is bound to necessitate a new organization in everything, including modern design, etc. We have to require imagination to make this new reality act upon the senses. The only meaning of the museum lies in its being a pioneer. The new type of art museum must not only be an art museum in the strictly traditional sense, but strictly speaking, not even a museum. A museum conserves supposedly eternal values and truths. But the new type of museum would be a kind of powerhouse, a producer of new energies. To collect the timeless spirit of quality, it acts as an encounter with life. Life in general, the contemporary art museum usually consists of two obsolete evolutionary stages. And these obsolete stages, which we are still present in all of our museums, are, it has Baroque component, represented by pictures and sculpture galleries. We have components of light and romanticism, etc. These two old components dominate the museum of today, and they are responsible for its static character. What we have today is, the new type of museum is to display the energy of the modern movement. Above all, it would recover like all new movements, this new type of museum will then be an important factor in the urgently needed integration of life and its unification of mankind on a dynamic basis. This was already published in 1947, but he didn't have the tools nor the language to express what he wanted to do. Now I show you what we tried at ZCAM to follow this idea of Dewey and Dorner to make a dynamic museum which gives the possibility to the audience to learn something, to be in the stream, in the energy of life. For example, next please, we have here a museum in Karlsruhe which has a great collection of 2,000 objects of the Turkish prey. So when Europe robbed in wars, and we got a lot of Turkish objects there. And normally, these objects are hidden behind a glass vitrine. You cannot touch them, you cannot rotate them. So we made a panoramic, a virtual museum, a dynamic projection for about each object, 2,000 objects, and then we made a device which is also possible online in the museum and online on the website. You can select an object, you can rotate the object, then you can make a close-up to those objects. That means you can see the object better online in the museum, better online on the website than in the museum itself. So because when you're in the museum, you're in a vitrine, you only have a certain distance, you cannot go closer to look at the museum, you cannot turn the object. So here we made it possible that the public could study singularly 2,000 objects in close-ups and rotate them and therefore come close to what we call experience. Yeah. Next, please. So we had a show 1999, which continued to 2000, about net art. At that time, everybody said it's impossible to make net art exhibitions because net art happens in the internet. And Sandy said, no, we are not speaking about net art, we speak about the net condition. So it means what are the social conditions that we invent net structures, the internet and webs, etc. And what are the conditions of the net that it allows us to make art with it. And then we created not only net-based installations in the museum, we also created a virtual museum in the net. People could really move three-dimensionally through the exhibition, and there was a certain point which was colored, so that people could press a button to this point, and then move into the next room. So people could curate, like you have through a city, like a tourist through a city could create through an exhibition, and create their own path and their own selection of the work. Next, please. When you look at a painting, you only see the last phase of restoration. Many of the paintings which we see today in museums are a dozen times repainted and changed. And there was a big scandal in Florence when the doctor of medicine took all the paintings by X-rays and other methods and showed what was behind these layers of different paints. Paintings which are 500 years old are repainted several times. So that means restoration, most of the time, means also destroying. So, because according to the ideology of the time, the restoration is changed. We give the audience example. We took a Lesigler painting from the Renaissance, and then we give them the audience devices, interfaces to the hand, and then they could look through the devices and see what are the different layers of different paintings behind. That means on one painting, the last layer, there was a baby in the hand of Maria, the saint, but then we realized before it was a kind of animal, it was not a baby. No? So the public had the chance to look through the surfaces, go beyond what I said, natural perception. So we could introduce the public to intellectual dimensions, why things are changing, why painting changes in the history of art. Next, please. We made a conference in 2000 to the science of the interference already. We invited quantum physics, we invited the information traditions, many other people to study with us the science of the interfaces. Next, please. Then we made a virtual museum in the city, also in our place. Yeah. So when you go in a museum, normally you are bound to the natural space. Yeah. And obviously this is not enough. We could create in the natural space, in the space of natural perception, with artificial interfaces, we can create other museums. Yeah. So when you've been sitting on this platform, you could move around, rotate the platform, then the screen was rotating in different directions, and opened you doors to other places and to other museums. And in these museums, you could find virtual objects which you did not see in the real museum. So we could expand the place of the museum into imaginary places. We could expand the flow of energy, so the flow of information, the flow of data into virtual spaces. Next, please. So this is what we do now at the moment. Study with other institutions different ways of interfaces to turn us away from the constraints of natural space, from the constraints of natural perception, into new domains of energy, information, and data. For example, when you go in a normal concert hall in a normal museum, then you're lucky and see a piece of sound art there. Most of the time, in the most museums where you go, you never see a piece of sound art, even when sound art exists 100 years already in the 20th century. So what we invented here, different apps. For example, is a music board. You have your own handy. And as you know, the handy has an electromagnetic field. We tell the handy precisely the position space. So you have 360 points, which can be linked to samples. And then you can, for example, you can select a certain kind of samples, baroque music, rock music, whatever. And then you move the handy in the space. Then this interface, it is interfaced to different samples. Then you can create your own music in the museum with new instruments, new interfaces. For example, the music board, as you see, there's a field. Then we invented a virtual ball. So when you move the handy, the ball is rolling around, he's virtual. By moving from one field to another, he triggers a new interface and a new sample. So what is important, what you see here now, we are moving into electromagnetic fields. We're not thinking anymore about space and about place. We replace the concept of space and place by fields, according to modern science theories about space. So we try to use the electromagnetic field. And each of us has his own electromagnetic field around it, and it counters other electromagnetic fields. We cannot control it at the moment. We cannot channel it. But we are trying at that time to enter this new electromagnetic field and try to control it and try to channel it, for example, with the handy. Next, please. We have the typewriter, which is a mechanical instrument, a typical witness of space and time in the old sense. But now you can roll again the sphere around, and with the sphere, you see these two red barriers. You can move these two red barriers in different directions. Then you can move the ball in different directions. And any time when a stick moves at the barrier, it creates a different sample of sound. So again, we are trying to use the magnetic fields as interface. Next, please. We have a huge collection of net-based installations. Next, please. Now, for the end, the philosophy, what is different for smart places is the following. Old places, old spaces, old museums, old cultural institutions, they have only a collection of objects, words, objects, images, objects and sounds. This is a classic analog world for the classical cultural institutions. You see a painting, you look at a book, you hear some sound, and they're more or less related to objects or related to themselves. Naturally, when you have abstract art, then you are not referential to the world, but you're referential to the elements of representation. So it is not really abstract, to make it once again clear. Abstract art is the wrong name. What we do, because normally what you do is you have a yellow color to represent a yellow lemonade. And now you say, yellow, I use as yellow. That means you use the color as self-reference. So it's still a representation, but a representation of itself. So when you say, now I make art with pure color and pure forms, it's not really abstract. It is just saying the means of representation represented themselves. The color, which is normally used as mean of representation, now is representing themselves. It's still in the horizon of representation. But today, as you know, the new space of energy, information, flow of data, etc., everything, each object, word, image, and sound can turn into data. So when you use a handy, images and spoken words, etc., are used to data and sent telematically distributed and turned back again. Yeah? This is a new idea. In the old world, words could not become objects. Images could not become objects. Therefore, this famous painting by Magritte, you see a pipe, and the sentence, this is not a pipe, because it's just a picture of a pipe, a representation. And you could not turn the pictures of a pipe into a pipe. But today, we can use data to turn, so the process is reversible. For the first time in the history of mankind, the relation between objects and words and data are reversible. Data can be reversed to words, images, sounds, and with 3D printing, even data can be reversed to objects. I show an example. There's a camera, next please, in Halifax, which makes a picture of the motion of oceanic waves. This reality, this moving surface of matter, which is turned from matter into information, becoming a picture depicted by camera. This camera then and computer turns this picture into data. This data are transmitted telematically by electromagnetic waves to Karlsruhe. And then we turn back the data to this kind of Cartesian grid, and this grid moves accordingly in real time to the waves in Halifax. So you see precisely what I say. Matter is turned into data. Data then are turned back to matter. This is what we are now. For another example, I told you, we are an electromagnetic field, and we can buy apparatuses which measure a little bit as much as we can at the moment, but in 10 years we can do it much better, to measure the behavior of an electromagnetic field. And when you come close to this liquid, this is, you see a black liquid, which is called ferrofluid. Ferro comes from the Latin word ferrum, iron. So when you take fluidity and give some iron, small particles of iron in it, then the fluidity becomes more stabilized. Therefore, when you come closer, then the camera, whatever, the computer, the sensors detect the quality of the electromagnetic field and they shape an eye. An eye which is stable. So you watch the first time, water is not just making a wave which disappears. The water forms an eye, and the eye is not only stable, but when you move around, the eye is following you. So we shape the form of, so we make the liquid water in the stable form. To give an example, in 10 years, you can make a drink of water made out of water. They don't need porcelain. We can make it with other examples. We can make examples that you take a glass of water which consists of water itself. And this is the first steps in this direction. That liquid stuff can be stable matter, and stable matter can turn back into liquid stuff. Next, please. To play again with electromagnetic fields and frequency. When you have, as you know, the discovery of electromagnetic fields happened here in Karlsruhe by Heinrich Hertz. Therefore, we speak in computers with gigahertz, etc., etc. So we can measure the chamber sound A has 400 hertz frequency. So we can measure now each drop of water, and you can say in 1 second comes 400 drops of water on the resonance floor, which is a parapluie. So people can go in a place. So you have a parapluie, then different speeds, different frequency of water drops fall on the parapluie and create different frequencies, that means create different music. On one source you hear rock and roll, on the other source you hear Beethoven. Do you synthesize? We don't use anymore any locally bound special instrument, no piano, nothing. We use only electromagnetic fields and information and data, and this information and data can have the mask of sounds and images. So what we are doing, when we move into smart places, we move through the mask of space and move into the space of energy, electromagnetic waves and data. Next, please. We go to the next one. So in the museum, when you enter the place, you encounter your different codes, genetic code, social code, etc. And we show you what happens to your data, because we are in a world living in algorithmically controlled data. So it's a little bit an illusion that we're still bodies and organisms. For the world outside of us, we are treated completely as data. And we show you it's the next step. Next, please. When you enter this position, maybe you show just the next. When you enter it, you see it's an empty screen, you take a book, the book is empty, Because and only through this window, you can see the information. So you see the book is empty. Because the code, the information is independent from the Declan carrier. Even our genetic code is independent from our own organism. We can take away our genetic code and plant it to another organism. This is what happens when people make sex. This is nothing else than taking your electric code and planting it to another organism. And all the drama of love has nothing to do just to bring together the organisms to transpose the genetic code. And you see now what happens. Next, we go back again. You see here. So we have an empty screen. You have an empty book. But through this glass, through this looking glass, which is a technical magic trick from us, because we have taken away from the projector the polarization filter. So all the information here is in the light. But when you look in the light, you don't see it. You see it on the screen. But the projector has a polarization filter. So when you take away the polarization filter, you don't see the information. We put the polarization filter onto the glass, so you could detect suddenly the information, which is contained as a Declan carrier, never in the book, but only in the light. So light is not color. This is old-fashioned analog world. Light is information. Next, please. And this is important to understand when people speak about digitization, digital space. They don't know that this is already a concept 400 years old. It started with Principia Mathematica, the mathematization of natural space, by Lagrange and by Newton. So then, 100 years later, 200 years later, it was George Boole who said precisely the method of Lagrange. You see it in, when you would go to his archive, in Scotland, then you would see, and you go into the archives, and you can find notes where he says, I will take the algebraic operation, precisely algebraic operation of Lagrange, to turn it into thinking. So what Lagrange did for the philosophy of nature, I do for the philosophy of thinking. So he wrote the book, as you see here, Investigation of the Laws of Thought. So he turned thinking into formal logic, and from logic into algebra, into mathematics. So this was the second step. And then finally, it was Shannon who discovered that the array and the rearrangement of switching circuits, what we call today switching algebra, can be mapped onto Boolean algebra. That means everything what we think can be formulated logically in mathematical formula. And when you have this mathematical formula, you can turn it into a diagram of switching circuits. And therefore, computers can think, because computers imitate the way how our brain processes information. With this invention, all these discoveries from 400 years entered in everyday life. So 400 years of abstract research, nobody interested. But at the very moment when with electronics, you could make machines like the smartphone, then suddenly people would say, it's digitization. No, digitization is a process of 400 years. Only now, when you enter it in everyday life, you discover it. For example, this a mobile phone has more than 1 million transistors. 50 years ago, the transistor radio had only 5 transistors. You see, in 50 years, we make such a progress. So you can imagine what we have in 50 years again. Therefore, next, please. For example, we can make a newspaper speaking. So normally you have a photograph from an event, then the journalist writes to you about what has happened. But we can say, no, when you put a documentary film in the internet, we can write an app that you can see the actual environment, the actual process, the actual event, without the commentary of the journalist. You can be witness by these interfaces to the real world. Next, please. So with kind of apps, we can make access to many, many other information tools. So what, next, please. When these digital tools, normally you go to a museum and the curator has made this selection for you. You have, for example, a collection of 1,000 photographs, then the curator says, I have an idea how to do it. Now the spectator can become his own curator. He can select 8 photographs from a collection of 1,000 photographs, because his photographs is behind so-called RFID, radio frequency identification. With this little sensor in the back of the photo, the computer knows which photo you have selected. So this lady is selecting 8 photographs, putting on the table. Then with the sensors, the computer knows what you have selected. Yeah. Now you go to a screen, you press the print button, then you make your own catalog. So you are not only just a stupid visitor, you play a curator, and you leave the museum as your own publisher. You bring your own catalog at home, yeah. Completely printed automatically. Because each object can be turned into data, and data can be turned into objects. Yeah. This is how we try to make dynamically, yeah, the space and the experience of art. Not just watch a photograph. Yeah. No, you can actively use exchange, yeah, with help of interfaces, and you have the experience of art and information. One of the architects which comes closely to this idea is the studio of Zaha Hadid. Yeah. The computer scientist of Zaha Hadid's studio is Patrick Schumacher, from her company, and he created the Parametricist Manifesto. Yeah. And this Parametricist Manifesto means nothing else, yeah, that you have many data. Yeah. With the help of this data, yeah, it's a parametric, yeah, you can shape a dynamic environment. Yeah. And he thinks that this parametricistic architecture is a follow-up of postmodernism and deconstructivism. Next, please. This is for sure, when we have talking assistance with intelligence, and we see clearly the future. Yeah. A normal code, when you talk to each other, is just instruction. Yeah. When you talk to an intelligent system, intelligent sensor, then it's not only instruction, it's also execution. Yeah. You can say, what is a Z-cam? Yeah. And this device, intelligent assistant, will give an answer. Huh? So it means, and this assistance, intelligent assistance, will become millions more than today. Like millions of transistors in a machine, in future we'll have millions of intelligent sensors around us. Huh? And they will become dynamic. Yeah, huh? And they will become sometimes more dynamic than me, because they have artificial intelligence. With artificial intelligence, that means you can process data faster and better than we do it. Yeah? So the future is precisely this kind of parametricist environment where intelligent agents are responsive, yeah, and develop an energetic, dynamic environment. Next, please. And we try to open this up already with this exhibition, Open Spaces. Yeah? So this space is not only an exhibition for trophies, no? We follow the ideas of Avi Warburg. Warburg, he wanted the museum to become, like Alexander Donner, a thinking space, a denkraum. With these 3 shows, together with the philosopher Bruno Latour, Iconoclash, Making Things Public, and Reset Modernity, and we call them, because in Germany we have the phrase Gedankenexperiment, thought experiments. When you make an experiment only with your brain, not with reality. And instead of Gedankenexperiment, we called our exhibitions Gedankenausstellung, thought exhibitions. Yeah? Precisely what Donner wanted, to motivate the intellectual resources of the objects displayed. And here we turn the museum in a working place. People can come in here, can leave here, can work here. It's a kind of co-working place. You can work alone, you can work with groups. Companies can hire the place to make workshops. So the museum turns in an experience, in the space of experience. And since it's a new concept, the entrance is free. And also we have free fruits and free coffee. Thank you.